Today, I am Manrich Kutse, based in South Africa, in Cape Town. I work at Capitec Bank, and I'm a team leader for the metadata management portfolio within data governance. And today, I'll be talking about the business case for a technology capability to transition through the different maturity levels for metadata. Just a bit of background from my point of view, I originally worked in the credit decision science team as a senior statistical data scientist. And I used to build scorecards, models, created algorithms, and all of those that supported business initiatives. I remember all the challenges we had with data. But I've since come to understand that, you know, most of them were related due to a lack of metadata and a lack of a data governance strategy in the bank. I love metadata. It's been fascinating me from the word go. Since it basically landed on my desk. So I was initially quite overwhelmed with metadata. I didn't necessarily understand all of it because I don't come from a techie background, more from a statistical, mathematical background. So it was quite daunting, but I did a lot of researching and discovering and analyzing what metadata is and how it fits into the data world from a business point of view, technical and operational point of view. So why metadata and why invest in metadata? Initially, I got a lot of blank stares when we introduced the idea of data governance and metadata into the company. Metadata isn't important for business. They don't even know what metadata is, some of them. They make money and that's it. And why should they care about metadata? We got the message across and made the connection with them that we are building the bank's knowledge management system. And that was very key when we started getting that message across. And you know, every single person in the bank, from a consultant in the branch or direct loans to the executive, can benefit from metadata. I need to position the Capitec data and analytics office. You'll see in the slide, this is just a very high level view of the structure that we have. We've got pockets under digital and business development. So you've got your digital and the business development team, your IT team, finance, marketing, credit, etc., filtering up into the CEO. But part of digital and business development is the data and analytics department. And you've got your one portfolio there, data governance. And within data governance, you've got your different areas, metadata, data quality, ownership, etc. So it depends. Obviously, there's different structures, but that's our structure. And just to give you an overview of what we look like, and currently there's about 150 people in the data and analytics office. And initially, data governance was positioned under data analytics, but it's since become a shared service across. And you know, right from the start, we actually just had four people driving data governance in the company, for which I was lucky enough to be one of them. And now we're 16 people. So you can really see the value is increasing, and you can see how we are actually creating the capability and driving coverage within the company. You know, before we kick off, there's some ground rules that we established. So, you know, we've got this drive for data governance as part of data strategy, but we really needed to create some ground rules for us. And, you know, to kick us off on this journey, we needed to determine what is our principles and guidelines that we wanted to follow. And there was specific critical success factors just to keep us in check of what we are actually trying to achieve. These critical success factors was really simple. And, you know, it was really key for us to keep aligning to this. And the one outcome of metadata should always be creating business value, especially in our environment that we are in. It's all about creating business value. We knew that we needed a technology capability to enable us to achieve that. And we knew that, you know, to introduce metadata into our company needed to be non-intrusive. So those were the three checkpoints or success factors that we always kept in mind right from the start, while we're still doing at the moment. The journey begins now. I mean, we've put down our critical success factors, and you know, the next steps will be to link the metadata strategy to the larger strategy and really kick it off. The next few slides, I'll show you how we align to our critical success factors and how we set out to achieve the goal of transitioning between the metadata maturity levels to get to a level 5. The next slide, I'll really sort of depict how we went about thinking about data and big mind attitude and really sort of grow and mature and create the capability. So we needed to think big, and this is just a nice slide to introduce that to you. Initially, you know, how did we do it? Business value. We identified what and where the pain points in the business were. We had a focus on business and how we can enable business value. So we linked up with the business strategy. But there were some steps to take first before we got there. So the first step was to conduct interviews in the business. And you can see there, this is a simple slide with a SWOT analysis. Yes, another SWOT analysis, but it's simple, perfect. It works. We interviewed 29 people across the business. So there was a balance between people in IT, technical people, and business people that we interviewed. It was qualitative interviews. It was two rounds that we conducted interviews on. And the focus was on issues that impacted their day-to-day jobs or the efficiency of business processes. And you'll see that it's quite interesting there in the middle that 86% of the interviewees felt that the lack of a central repository and manual and the fact that they needed to do manual impact analysis was a major weakness in the business. And, you know, additionally, it was no surprise that more than half of the interviewees felt that a metadata management tooling capability or technology was an opportunity for us. So this slide, you know, I'm not going to go into the slide in a lot of detail. There is quite a few detail in the slide, but what this slide provides you with is a nice view, overview on the components that should be in place for each maturity level. So it's a good stake in the ground that you can put to understand where are you with your metadata management. Additionally, what it shows you is how to transition from one level to another. And, you know, really summarizing this slide, is that the fact that the one common theme to transition from one maturity level to the other is that you need a technology capability to allow you to progress and elevate metadata in order to transition through these maturity levels. Okay, well, the next step, where do we go? So the first one is, how do we align to the strategy? This is not an easy task. It's definitely not easy to do. You really need to think about the bigger picture, and you need to link your initiative to the bank's overall strategy to ensure you drive business value. By doing this, you're opening up the opportunity for your executives. You're opening up opportunity for sponsorship, and you're really enticing the executives to climb on top of this. You'll see at the top, you have your overall bank strategy for data governance. You've got your data strategy or your metadata component linked up into that. And then, you know, you're highlighting the benefits of metadata. So this is still very theoretical. So, you know, the next steps is, so what? Let's make it real. How did we do this? We took the strategy to the executives and we failed. And the message was, you know, why technology? Why this tool? You can't just theoretically say that this is the right thing to do. You need to really prove it. You need to prove that this will add business value. So we needed to make it real and practical to the executives. You know, that is what they're after. They want to understand what is the value in there. And we needed to prove why the cost should be substantiated for this. This is not a small investment. It's quite an investment. And in our environment, they're very cost effective and they're very much business value driven. You know, what we started off was then, right after that, was to align the business drivers behind metadata into the larger strategy. And I'm sure the business drivers that you see on this slide is what you've seen before. It creates capacity by the technology providing you visibility and traceability of your data. You have a view on what data can be reused and why and what shouldn't be reused. You're shortening the time to market. You're reducing the risk. It's still very theoretical. So, but at least it gives you one more leg in your strategy. But still, it's not good enough. So in the next slides, I'll show you know, how we made it real. Yes, so this is the punchline. the actual business case and the quantification of how we took it to the executives. And, you know, I mentioned that you needed to make it real to executives. They want numbers. They want the values, the benefits weighed up on the investment to drive the theory. That, you know, they want to understand what's the trade-off between the value that they're going to get and the investment. And I quantified the value for them. And we really digged into the business to quantify and aligning the benefits to real current processes that's in progress. So this slide is one example. There's a lot of them, and I'm happy to share them. So this was a simple, you know, capacity cost calculation, and it turned into an opportunity cost that you can gain. It's simple. The message is that, you know, you just need to start going. You need to get started. In this example, you've got your calculation shown there on the left. I'm not going to go into too much detail, but the example is that, you know, you've got an analyst that has two reports a month that he needs to create or she needs to create. And they need to provide the lineage of that report. They need to understand where the data is coming from. So they now need to do a manual investigation to understand, to scroll through stored procedures and code to understand where data is coming from. So the assumptions there at the bottom was that it takes about 6 hours to do that per report. If there's 50 analysts and all of them have two reports a month, that's about 2.8 million rand a year that you're spending on your analysts doing manual impact analysis. And you know, how do you now quantify the value of the technology? And it's very simple. We literally did a stopwatch exercise. You know, we brought in the technology and we said, okay, well, you do the manual impact analysis, and Mr. Y, you use the tool. And the person that used the tool did it in about a quarter of an hour, a quarter of the time quicker. And so that means that you're gaining 75% benefit from incorporating the tool. And we didn't just do one exercise. It was quite a few of them. So that 75% benefit that you're gaining turns into about 2.1 million rand of benefit quantified. And that's one example again. You can then turn that into an opportunity. Well, I mean, that benefit is 2.1 million rand. If it takes about 40 hours roughly a week to productionize a report, and there's 50 analysts, that means each analyst can productionalize 2.7 more reports a year. And that, if you have 50 analysts, that's about 135 reports additionally that you would have created that would have added value to your business. So that is just one example, but this is a real good view on how you can just make it simple and just use your current processes and alleviate of that to determine the benefit. Once the realization of the value sunk in, it was a mammoth task of evaluating which technology to go with. And, you know, obviously you've got a budget that you're working with. So we always had to remember the critical success factors that we set out right at the start that should check, that should keep us in check. So the approach was to create scorecards to do the evaluation. And we broke up the evaluation in three phases. And we aligned the scorecards in that way as well. You've got your must-haves, as you can see on the slide there. You've got your must-haves. You break that up into components, technical and business. And you create the scorecards in order to actually score the vendors that you're evaluating over the three phases. We started off with six vendors in phase one. You know, using simple demo environments, and then evaluating them. We dropped off two vendors. We had four vendors left for phase two. We used the scorecards again. We dropped off another two vendors. We were kept left with another two. And then, you know, phase three was where we incorporated more engagement. So more questions and answers. We looked at support processes. We looked at, you know, the long-term view, the integration into the business, et cetera. So there's more detail in there. And we dropped off another vendor there, and we were kept with one vendor, which is obviously Calibra. And we did a POC with them. And we rechecked the critical success factors, and we rechecked, you know, the actual benefit that we would gain from using Calibra. And Calibra adhered to all of our must-haves, and they scored high in all of our scorecard components. you know, the Calibra would allow us to maintain alignment with our critical success factors, and it was a good fit. I mean, we're very happy, and that is our approach from an evaluation point of view. So where do you start? I mean, you've obtained the technology, and you know it's integrated, it's implemented, and now you need to determine a use case to start off with. I utilize scorecards, and I created this opportunity matrix. This is one of my favorite slides to present on. You know, the scorecard, well, the one scorecard was to give you a view of the business value of that use case. You really dive into that use case, into that area, and you determine what will the business value be for us to enter there. And then the other scorecard is to determine the feasibility of entering that environment. And that, you know, for you, ideally, you would want to be in the top right quadrant on the slide. And that gives you an idea that you're adding a lot of, extracting a lot of business value, and it'll be relatively easy and non-intrusive for you to go into that environment. And they're probably relatively mature with their metadata. They've maybe got a dictionary lying around there. And it's a department that's been there for years and really taken care of their data assets. So that would be an easy start-off point. But this view, it creates a nice view for you to understand, you know, what is it? Where would you want to start? You don't want to start with something that doesn't add business value, or it's really not going to be as simple to extract the metadata in that environment. You really want to start off with a use case that's it's got a lot of business value, it's relatively easy to enter, and you know, you can share the success story after that. So that's the process on a high level. I'm available for any questions. You can email me at manrichkotze@capitecbank.co.za. You can work through Calibra to get hold of me as well. I'm happy to share more detail if you would like to. I'm happy to answer any questions as well. For this presentation, I would just like to leave you with the saying, tandem fit arbor circulus, which means eventually a twig becomes a tree. Thank you very much.